Hello, this is Cock and Bull coming live to you far in the interiors of India in a small little village called Andheri West. That's right. I had to traverse from early morning. I finally found it. I'm here. You can see it's a different location. And I cannot play my favorite game, which is Dictionary Word of the Week, with these two unperds who come on the show. And that's because I don't have my Oxford with me. That's only in the office. But I do have a lovely story, which is not funny from any angle. It's a sad and poignant story. For the last 6 days, I've been shooting for a show, which I shouldn't mention, in a place called Aremil Colony, which is a controversial area. Now, that place is famous for having the odd leopard, the last bastion for leopards in our part of the world. And we pack up generally at 7:38 in the night time, which is when you may come across them. They're generally nocturnal, like I used to be. So you won't believe my luck. True story. I swear on my mother, this is true. This is going to make the hair in the back of your neck stand up. Especially if you have only hair in the back of your neck, like one of our panelists. So I was leaving about 7:40, 7:45, and I asked the chauffeur to keep the car a little away from the location so that we can exit. As in, we'll do the walk, avoid all the vehicles and the, you know, the trucks and generator vans that can block you. And so we can make a smooth exit, because I'm all about exiting places. It's never about the work you do, but how you end and leave fast. That's my thing. So anyway, the walk was about maybe 90 seconds. Because it's all muddy and it takes a little while to walk, although it's not that much of a walk. But it's undergrowth. There's grass everywhere. There are trees everywhere. And you won't believe it. I swear to you, on everybody I love in the world, I suddenly saw the printed sort of, you know, spots, just a little bit camouflage against the underbrush of, you know, a lot of green. And then in between that green patch, I could see the spots. And I froze because I was alone. The chauffeur was already in the car waiting for me, and nobody was walking with me. And I was just walking alone, and there was about 30, 40 yards behind, 30, 40 yards in front with nobody around. And it was dark because now it was nearing 8 p.m. And it was me and Bagheera, you know, literally. I couldn't believe it. I was in awe, I was in love, and I was in deadly fear. All this at the same time. It's how I remember my wedding night also. And so I looked there, I looked at it. I froze. I couldn't walk. I was so worried. And I couldn't shout because I was worried that would, you know, start an attack and a dinner for the carnivore, not being me this time. And then it happened. The undergrowth parted and it came towards me slightly. And it was my makeup woman, Jyotika, who was wearing a printed leopard outfit on top. This is all a big, you know, misunderstanding. And I was so upset. I was so upset. I took about 2 days to recover from that, because I thought I had, in nature, man in the wild, man versus beast, I had come across the top predator of India, the leopard who survives everything. And instead it was Jyotika, who also survives everything and perhaps eats a little too much. But let's not mention that. Let's bring in the panelists. We have a very eminent Amit Doshi and Sivri. This is a true story, Amit. I didn't make this up. True story.
Could have also been the ghost of a leopard, because Are Colony is haunted. I don't know if you know.
Yeah, I know that too. But that doesn't bother me so much, you know.
No.
Because yeah, I'm not so worried. What's the ghost going to do to you? What's the panga the ghost will have with a guy who's working there for a few hours and leaving? We're not really the people they want to interact with. They're government officers, BMC, activists, you know, all that. People who own the property, yes. Here, I was just worried because you read about these sightings all the time. And honestly, I was in a no man's land patch. I'm not lying about that. 10 seconds, I was a little worried. And I didn't know what to do. I just froze there for a second. And I actually saw it was leopard print. It was this stupid woman walking in the background somewhere, going back towards the civilized part of town. I was so angry with her, Jyotika. And who wears prints in these days anyway? You know, the fake plastic prints, which if you see in light, it doesn't even look like leopard print. But there for a second with your mind playing games, it actually happened. So, wow. But what an experience it was. If it really happened, it was a real leopard. Could you believe it? And he just left me alone and walked off. Which is probably what would have happened. Amit, you're on mute.
Amit, you're on mute.
Sorry about that.
Oh, no, okay. You asked her about this. Did you ask her about it?
Ask her.
I mean, like, was she wearing leopard in Are because Are, or was it like, you know, to hide from the other leopards, or to make
she?
Or
she's a loud dresser. You know, every day there were these 11 colors on the shirt and all that. You definitely remember her. And like I'm saying, it's not those prints that are very casual and subtle and actually should fool you, which I think on handbags, they work better, those prints.
Okay.
This is a loud print. But keep in mind, I only got to see like a square between this undergrowth of bushes and all that and a couple of trees and everything. It was very green, dark. And then I just saw that thing, and it was more a yellow tinge and little spots. So your mind plays games also. No? You start crossing the putting the dots together, which aren't there.
No, your evolutionary mind. I mean, like you see something that looks like an animal, and you know your flight or fright.
Exactly. And my super brain was already telling me Indian leopard smaller than African leopard should not be more than 100, 115 pounds. If you can keep your nerve, it's like fighting a Rottweiler. It's not the worst thing. You know, you should be able to handle it. Try and get on top, hold them. But there's no collar with the damn leopards. So they're faster. But these thoughts were going through my mind. Also, my urine, I think, started leaking at the same time because it is scary. And where we were, it's just scary because at that point, it was really like a no man's land thing.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, there have been a lot of sightings. When I was shooting in the early days with MTV, we did a lot of work at RA Mill Colony because it was cheaper and open and there was less problems. Amit, you've shot there enough.
They've
warned us specifically because we used to do outdoor shooting, so we don't have to pay. So you're shooting things on the road, you're shooting things crossing, all that crap. And they warn us after 7, you please be careful.
Yeah.
Nobody knows. The leopard is the most reinventive sort of cat. It can thrive anywhere. It does in malad societies with those high rates.
Have you seen those videos of leopards in the chamber buildings and taking dogs and all?
Yeah.
Like, who's sleeping?
Yeah. Taking dogs?
They're on YouTube, dogs these videos.
As the main prey, but they also attack babies. They like small prey.
Yeah,
they can
just carry away. Yeah.
Yeah. So if you have a really fat baby, you should be safe. You can leave the fat baby down. Be like, leopard? No, no, no.
Are leopards the animals that basically take their prey into trees to eat them, or is that cheetahs?
Yeah. Yeah. No, no. Cheetahs can't climb trees. But leopards do, and they always attack from behind. That's the other problem. They're stealth attackers. They don't go for the underthroat thing and all. They
and
go
super
from
silent also.
Yeah. Super silent. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. So in my colony, I've been living here for about 12 years. No, actually, right. Close to 15 years now. And about 5 years before we moved in.
I don't know what to say for that information. It's so interesting. I've been in this studio for about 45 minutes. Yeah, go on.
About 5 years before we moved in, there's a famous story in the colony about how a leopard broke into the colony through a gate. We share a gate with the shipping corporation, which shares a gate with RA colony, something like that. And so from the shipping corporation, a leopard came in and actually killed a child or took a child away, like a 10-year-old kid away. Like a 10-year-old kid away.
But even a smallish size 10-year-old. I think they go more on the size from what I've read. So it's more the size thing. 10-year-old looks 8, for example, is bad luck. 10-year-old looks 12, much better. So they gauge their percentile and go for it. They probably would not attack 2 Rottweilers or something like that, or really large dogs. They want the small desi dog that they can get. Quick top of the back of the neck, and then they take the animal and run off. So they have to be more, and they're very powerful, their jaws, no question.
But I mean, like a 10-year-old kid seems like of a size that would be difficult for a leopard to manage. Like 2-year-old, 3-year-old, 4-year-old, I get,
But 2-year-old, the age wrong. Adult is there. Actually, no, I don't think of the age wrong. It's mostly between 6, 7 to 10 because the adult is not there. They have to find the kid who's isolated, playing marbles, do whatever. And the 2 times in your youth where you're alone is one when you're that 6 to 10 thing and you don't want to be around the parents, you want to explore. And as a male, 12 to 16, when you start playing with yourself. Those are 2 issues that I remember growing up very clearly, this period, that period. But so in some societies, they tie the face mask on the back in villages and all where you have this kind of thing going on. So your face or some human face is there. Mm-hmm. So that it's deterred to come from that side. Then it sort of won't attack. There's a good chance it won't attack. It won't attack where your face is, so that can fight back.
Can you wear that Kejriwal neck muffler? Wouldn't that be the best defense if you think about it?
Or you can keep him with you. You can keep him with you because I don't think they go into AAP. As far as I know, they've been supporting the BJP. BJP is their party. Yeah. Let's eat what we want when we want. Yeah. But a bit sad, no? Because they're attacking all our animals, the dogs and kids. And okay, kids aren't our animals, but you know what I mean? So there's that problem. And the second thing is, where do they go? Poor things, they're coming closer to Chembur, Pawai, Malad, and then slowly, slowly. I mean, they'll never come to Walkeshwar, Amit, because it's not worth it. It's just too expensive.
Also, did you see the map, the 2050 sinking map?
Yeah, it's scary. You think
But even if it's scary, actually, even my house is off is not going to sink, and I live right next to the sea.
Apparently, not really.
Cuff Parade is going to go, all that Mantralaya area is going to go.
All the reclaimed stuff is going. Basically, what that map looked like is that basically all the reclaimed land of Bombay.
Yeah, that's true. We are pure hill. We are pure hill.
We are the original island. Yeah.
You tell our listeners what you're talking about. So this is the BMC chief has come out. This is talking about a study which was recently conducted by, I think, McKinsey. The UN.
He's just so happy to not talk about the pandemic. You know, he was like, let's discuss. I got something for you. Today is something different.
So,
check this
out. So basically they're saying is that a lot of Mumbai, not a lot, like around the coastal side of Mumbai will be submerged by the year 2015 underwater.
Where the sea is obviously there, there seems to be no chance. But I think that's true. What can you do? So get yourself flippers and an oxygen mask and hope for the best. But
work on climate change. That would help too.
I think it's too late. It's like saving the Parsi.
You reach
the mathematical point where you can't change the numbers. No? You can do all this, but can you really make a tribe of...
You might not be able to reverse... Well, Parsis is different.
Okay, forget Parsis, it's maths. So you can come to a point where you cannot increase the graph and to sustain it for numbers to sustain for growth, and that compounds. And if you don't compound, you can't grow. So the decline can be slower. That's basically it. The decline to destruction and extinction can be slower. It's a similar thing with the tigers at the moment. Even though they're 3,000, it's nothing to shout and be happy about. It's nowhere close to safety. For a species.
It's not, but it can be, but the tigers can be revived. It's not impossible to revive the tigers. It's not impossible to revive wildlife like that. Similarly, it's not impossible to kind of, I don't want to say reverse global warming, because you're not going to be able to reverse the damage already done, but you can definitely prevent additional damage from being done.
But now my wife has made a new rule. If you're feeling a sense of flatulence, you have to go into the bathroom. Now, no longer can we just pass wind in my house.
Really?
It's just becoming worse. It's like the government. They're just taking away all our rights, you know. And she's been very clear now that, and everybody, if you're feeling that sort of upheaval in your body and digestive tract, which is basically me, because the kids are a little bit, you know, when you're younger, it's not that bad an issue. So off you go. So it's so unfair. Your own house, which you pay for, you have to go and have a little private moment every few minutes. Coming back to the tiger, by the way, the last sighting, and correct me, listeners, if you're listening or know more about this, in the 60s, where we live, where Amit and I live, Walkeshwar, Malba Hill, that whole thing, there were the last tiger sighting was right there in the 60s.
What?
Yeah, 50s or 60s. It's as close as that.
You're seriously in Bombay?
As these buildings, the buildings were all built in the 60s, most of the buildings in that area. So there was a tiger sighting right till then, apparently.
Wow, that's incredible.
And a tiger has a very long range, no? In terms of 30, 40 miles or even more, 100 maybe. So then, generally, there's no second tiger in that whole area, male tiger in this whole area.
You just made me Google this. And there was a tiger in Mumbai in 2003. Close to Mumbai.
No. Those are tigers who are, wherever they are, trying to find their way to,
From the National Park.
I'm talking about South Bombay, the hilly. Look, we were a mountain. Amit,
you and I
are the last two mountaineers of India. In that sense, Aditya Gupta, no disrespect whenever you come on the show. but can you imagine? So, you're building a building, there's a tiger somewhere in the vicinity in South Bombay. What you're talking about is some. Give me the 2003 detailing, I'd love to know.
It's basically, it says in the Borivali National Park. It came nearby, but it was not. It didn't come all the way. It was basically moving around. It was that. The tiger was moving around from the Dungs forest in Bhuj, Gujarat through Nashik, Thane and Tunganeshwar forest through Maharashtra to come here.
It was doing Maharashtra Darshan.
I'm reading this also. The last time there was a tiger in Mumbai was 1927.
You're calling me out on my 1960s?
Well, I mean, like, no, they're saying this in part of the same article. They're saying this, so I'm just... throwing that out there.
Yeah. But, you could argue that, you know, we do have a tiger dancing left, right, and center since the last 10 years or so.
10 years?
Jackie Shroff's son. So, technically, they live in spirit around us. But it's really sad. I feel, I don't know what the solution is. They're going to relocate leopards now. Cheetahs, which had become extinct. We're going to start the relocation this year, apparently. So, let's see if that works.
Honestly, the solution to a lot of this stuff is stuff that people don't like, right? I mean, like the idea that you got to stop deforestation. You can only stop
deforestation.
You got to
do reforestation.
You got to do the opposite. But that only happens through additional urbanization. The only way that you stop deforestation is through additional urbanization. Move people to the cities. Or incentivize people to move to the cities, right? So that the rural area
doesn't get urbanized more. Yeah.
Doesn't get more urbanized, doesn't get more like farmed and stuff like that. That's the problem, right?
Areas where the outskirts where the poor panther or leopard is trapped all the time, shouldn't people like Silvery like demolish their building and allow the space to go to the leopards and come back to town?
No, see, that's actually, in all honesty, I think that you're right from the joke perspective, and I'll let the joke stand.
Thank you so much. I doff my hat. Thank you so much for that.
But from a practical perspective, no, because what you need is you really need megapolises, right? You need like really, really huge cities, well infrastructured, but huge cities, right? So the landmass of Bombay is actually tiny, right?
Mr. America, explain one thing to me. They've allowed the cougar, well, not allowed, but the cougar is still around, okay?
Yeah.
And the cougar can enter any suburban in certain areas where they
it happens.
You know, proliferate.
Yeah.
It happens. And in a sense, they've not really come in. The man-animal conflict happens a lot in America.
It does.
Okay? So yeah. They've all not
a,
got a
it's
proper...
a much larger country. I think we lost Cyrus.
No, I'm here.
Oh, okay, all right, yeah. You froze for a second there. It's a much larger country, right? I mean, like from just the amount of land that they have is much, much more than what.
Worked out a system where they have a sort of middle path or one area for, as you say, one area for not even rural. I don't know what the right word is. One area where the animals can thrive without human contact. Okay,
but
they haven't been able to do that. So Yellowstone,
actually,
but other than that.
No, they have like a really, really big national parks program, right? Like really big national parks where you're not allowed to do any kind of development or anything like that. And again, it's not perfect, right? I mean, like, of course, there's a lot of encroachment, especially when you get into suburban areas and that kind of thing, right? But there is a lot of animal and human conflict. Bears get into the city sometimes.
Yeah.
And especially as global warming is happening, this will become a bigger problem up north because now the natural habitats are shifting, so it is an issue. There's no getting around it. You're starting to see more and more of this kind of thing all over the place.
They have a major coyotes, and like raccoon problem.
Those
being
scavenger animals, they are used to them being on the periphery and generally are not that scary except for taking chicken and whatever. But the bigger ones like the cougar and the black bear and all, the grizzly bear in some parts, I mean, that's a no contest if you come across one of those.
Also, the coyote in some ways is like the leopard, right? You hear a lot about leopards encroaching into urban areas because it happens in Mumbai. Similarly, you hear a lot about coyotes because it happens in LA. Right.
Yeah.
But in India, the biggest encroachment problem is monkeys, right? We don't talk about monkeys ourselves.
Oh, I didn't tell you. We have two monkeys on the terrace.
In your building?
You know, we've got scaffolding is going on. I don't mean the, I'm not talking about the pariks. I'm talking about two monkeys. So half the building is, the scaffoldings are up. Out of four areas, two have scaffoldings. And not that they need that. They can climb pipes or whatever. So somebody took pictures.
Can I ask you a question? Go ahead. Yeah.
No. So I wasn't there. I've been actually working for the last 1 week. Oh. My mom says that, so there's a platform in the kitchen hall area where the scaffolding is. And she opens the drapes at 8 in the morning. I had left at 6. And two monkeys are sitting there.
Yeah.
And my dogs went berserk, barking. And the monkeys didn't flinch. They stood there and they sat there and looked and were scratching themselves. And they were not worried. There was no fear.
It's happened to me. I mean, like, I've had monkeys show up when I used to work out at Nariman Point. When we had work going on in the building, we had a monkey right outside my window. I have a photograph of it somewhere on Facebook.
So what's the thing? How do they know work's going on? That means they're already there. It can't be that they do recce from time to time and say, okay, fellow monkeys, good news. Skylark is being done. Let's go have a good time. Fourth floor, non-vegetarian. Actually, they're fruit lovers. I'd love to know where they were till then. I suppose they're in that hanging garden area. There's a couple of monkeys.
There are spaces where they're at. But then how do they get to... The one that really blew my mind was how did they get to Nariman Point, man? There's nothing around there for them to hide in.
Bro, Nariman Point in the 90s, late 90s, early 2000s fell. The market crashed a little bit. That's when the monkeys made their move. It's clear. But before that was impossible. I mean, I always thought I wanted a office of some significance in Nariman Point. Growing up, wasn't that the chop that you're one of the movers and shakers of Mumbai? And then suddenly that sort of changed about 10, 15 years ago. And now it's BKC.
This is a very common fixture up north, though, like in places like Delhi and Agra, because I've spent a lot of my life there. Monkeys like showing up at the top of your house and all is very
With no fear of humans because they've been in contact.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is a little scary because when they have no fear of humans, they can come in, they can take things from your hand, and they're very powerful and strong also. And of course, people in my building chat go, "How cute, so sweet." I was like, "If that monkey gets into your room with you, I want to see the picture then." Yeah. Hey guys, here's an idea. If we had to give away one state to animals, predators and what have you, all types of animals, a whole state. Exactly what Amit's saying, but we just take one of our 30 states and we give that to animals and we keep the rest. So we have to then take those citizens and obviously divide them across the remaining 29, 30 states. So which state do you recommend should be given? And I say this by apologizing to members of that state because it's just a thought. This is not a prejudice. Which is the state that you give to the tiger, the leopard, the monkey, the bear?
If this was the US, you would say Florida because Florida is the punch of is the punchline to a lot of jokes.
I think they'd go with Amit. Correct me if I'm wrong. Wouldn't they go with what is the rectum? Buffalo? Isn't Buffalo supposed to be the real hellhole? Like you don't want to be
Buffalo. Buffalo is New York State.
Yeah, but isn't it like a place where you don't want to be?
Dakota probably maybe. Maybe one of the Dakotas. I don't know, man. I mean, all of these places are good in some ways, right? They're all got there on charm.
He's protective over the American states. Come back to Desi stance.
No. Even the American states, I'm not protective over. Even the Desi states, right? Also because I'm just from a practical perspective, right? How many different ecosystems do you need for all of the? I'm sorry, my mind goes in weird directions, right? But how many different ecosystems do you need for all this wildlife to kind of do? And is there a state that has all of these various ecosystems in India? You need jungle. You need jungle and forest. You need river.
Look at the large state of UP. It has everything if you look at it. I mean, from north, south, east, west, look at everything. You have the tiger there. You have the leopard there. You already have monkeys everywhere. Bears can be relocated. I'm sure they are there. Wolves originate from UP.
I guess so maybe.
Have we come? Should we put it down to a vote? Which is the state then? You said UP, Bengal, though, Silvery.
I mean, yeah, because tigers. They have forests there, right?
Sundarbans, as you go into Bangladesh and all, you got water, the fisheries and all that.
But you're doing the entire state. So if you're doing the entire state, I say give them a smaller state. So like Goa. So they can go have a good time also. Go on vacation.
Goa is
trees. There are tall trees.
You can just many animals won't be able to survive in Goa. There's not that much. What he said about different topography that you need.
Survival of the fittest. I believe
that's not fair.
If you're doing plain evolution, survival of the fittest, then why change anything, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
I'm happy. Where's my elephant going to go in Goa? He'll be like, "What do I do here? I'm not into beach parties or rave." But
yeah, you'll get
I like UP because UP has everything. It's a huge state, and this is no disrespect to UP, which is a beautiful state, or to UP Chief Minister, who may be the next Prime Minister. I'm just saying, we have to sacrifice one state. Maharashtra is another one, by the way. I feel Maharashtra's topography
does not have any cold weather. We don't have any
mountains. As you go up the mountains, or the hill stations and all, even in May, you're okay. Come on.
So you're talking about migration season? That's why? Like cold weather?
No, you're talking about animals like the bear.
Just animals. You need cold weather.
You know, the black bear all needs cold weather. They'll just, it's horrible how they have to survive Mumbai with those. When we were young, remember, I don't know, Silvery, you might have escaped it luckily. Amit and I definitely saw those bears with the thing in their nose where they used to, dancing God, bear. It would bleed from here because basically the leash was here in between the nostrils.
It was the cruelest thing.
Really, the things we've done to animals and to fellow human beings, how the hell is there a God? How do you explain religion? But the things we do, I mean, there's no recourse. It's ridiculous.
I don't get it. It's the cruelest thing I've ever seen, right? I mean, honestly, seeing those guys with the bears is just awful.
Yeah. What a beautiful beast, you know? What a powerful looking animal.
It looks so terrible too. By the time you see them, they're sickly and
that's
dying.
What I'm saying. To see that mighty animal in that state where he's lost all sense of, that majesty that he had or once had, stripped off that. Amit, it's like looking at you today from what you were in the 90s. You were a beautiful young man walking in the streets of Walkeshwar, going, righty, lefty, righty, lefty. I'm talking about their political activism. Our area has no political activism. Have you understood that? Generally speaking, no one is politically conscious enough to have a slightly profound conversation, or there's no depth in the conversation whether you're leaning left, right, or center.
I don't know about that, man. I don't agree with that. I think that
just because you favor some policies doesn't mean that you're really seriously thinking about anything. I'm talking about political consciousness. The South Mumbaikar, especially our area, zero. I'm pretty convinced.
I think it depends on who you hang out with. I hang out mostly with people who are into like this, right? Who are politically kind of they pay attention.
One of your best friends is the famous Prasisha's son. So these are all different backgrounds. These are very rare backgrounds that they have. I'm talking about the normal gentry that we find, and definitely, right. And without being bringing gender parity or reversing it, definitely the female folk.
There's no risk. Dude, I mean, like, I don't think that's true in my friend circle at all, right? Like, one of my closest friends is, you know a lot of my friends, like Menka, the Bloomberg Quint lady.
Yeah.
Samran.
I had a big crush on her.
Yeah. Okay. Samran.
1 year junior to me in college. Very pretty, huh, Silvery?
She was not 1 year junior than to you in college. She was 1 year junior to me.
So 2 years junior. Why are you pulling at hairs? What a terrible thing to say.
Samrata as well, right? So, I mean, again, he's very politically kind of aware and interested and kind of this, right? So, I mean, like, it really depends on who you hang with, yeah?
Leave out your five friends, and I'm telling you, my survey will survive the test of time.
But my point is self-selecting. My point is that you decide who you hang with, right?
Yeah, but that doesn't really count because, you know, yeah, birds of a feather, now that we're talking animals, you might as well use the same metaphors.
Yeah.
So birds of a feather, so you find politically conscious, interested people who have political thought in their head and think about things from a more macro sort of angle. But I think we are very microized society, if I have to be very open. I think people just think about themselves in Bombay, only in Bombay. I don't feel this in Delhi. I definitely don't feel this in like a Cal or in the smaller cities. But definitely in Bombay and South Bombay for sure. In Powai, I don't know. In Powai, do you think it's the same?
I'm not sure.
How politically aware are your friends in your area? Not your like comedian friends, because those are all like
they're okay. Yeah. Like they're okay.
Non-comedic friends.
Yeah. Again, so like I don't know how many of them are showing up for like a protest or something, you know. So
obviously not. The, yeah. Until the metro works, you can't reach protests.
Yeah.
They promise us 2021, man.
Yeah. So again, I want to be clear about that. My friends are not politically active in the sense that they don't go and like jandum.
That's activism. Like,
yeah, they're not activists like that, but they're aware. They know what's going on in the world, and they have opinions about what's going on in the world.
No, and you can't run away from the political background when you have a conversation. Yeah. Everything is politics and the social angle has to come into it, both. So, yeah. So I'm saying the people who are just divorced from that, their conversation will be purely on the Netflix show and not with relative terms to what's happening around in the world. That's a beautiful thing.
You're right. I have friends who are actually on the other side as well. Right? I'm just thinking now that I'm kind of digging into it. These are the people who I spoke to mostly in the pandemic. But I have a lot of friends who we are talking about. Again, people who you know, right? Like Prashant, the restaurant guy. He's not exactly interested in politics in any way.
Yeah, Prashant won't be. Prashant, if you're listening, no disrespect. You like the ladies and all that. There's all good points for that. But you're not the... Yeah, he's not going to be the next Aristotle and hold long... challenging conversations about problems with the world. Not that we are either, because that's just sounding like we're the great philosophers. Mm-hmm. Not that. But I just think that they don't have that worldview or India view when they have conversations. It's always just that.
It's basically they come from a place which is not grounded in politics or is not kind of...
There's not have a selfishness to it, but it may not be overtly done or not something that's done, you know, in a jaan bujh ke, as we say. It's just, but it's there. There's a certain selfishness because you live in a little world and you die in your little world. Maybe that's the best thing to do. If you have to take a break, guys, because I want to spray my hair now.
Yes, okay. Are they going to color your hair or is that just water?
Is that oil?
No. This is a very cheap shoot, so I'm not going to color my hair.
Okay.
We are our worst, basically. Which coming from me is a lot, really, to be honest.
But what is the hair product, though?
Huh? It's
let's take a break.
Actisol Plus Instant Cleanser.
Oh, okay.
It's to ward away germs for some reason. They insist on us using it. All right, we'll take our break, and when we come back, some hard-hitting topics from the three philosophers who are always looking at things in relative terms to humanity and to the social aspects and to how the entire world is one, at which point you can play the keyboards and start singing Ebony and Ivory. Go. Why one of us should be able to play some instrument, no? To keep the show alive. even with background music, like you say, and the leopard was standing in the underbrush, and then Silvery goes ting ting ting. It just creates you. You can do so much with that. So can you play anything except your own organ, Silvery?
I can play video games. I'm pretty good at that.
I think I'm gonna swallow the hair product and just end my life as quickly as possible. Yeah. All right. So do we have a topic as usual?
Yes, we
talked
do.
About animals for 30 minutes and then
we do.
Amit's friends who are also animals. Yeah.
So New Zealand right now is going through a lockdown, like strict lockdown. They're calling it level 4 restrictions down New Zealand. And
because they had one case.
No, they had some, but they're like they're already always paranoid about
six cases. That's my building, for God's sake.
I don't know the number of cases.
Listen, Australia and New Zealand are getting a slightly right wing, if I may use that term, label from the rest of the world because they're so paranoid. Even now, the England team going for the Ashes in cricket, 10 or 11 members say they don't want to go to Australia because of the quarantine thing and all the options that they'll have to go through. So I'm just telling you that they're getting a bit of a bad name as being real sticklers. You know, while the rest of the world has been a little flexible because how do you go on if you don't find a middle road? Sorry. Yep. So, New Zealand back to level 4 for 6 cases.
Yeah. This, a couple of days back on 27th of October, of August.
What are you taking?
No, sir. October. I don't know why I said that. So, 27th of August, an Instagram account called... an Instagram account had called for protests on Queen Street in New Zealand, anti-lockdown protests. Okay, and cops were like on high alert. They're like, "Oh shit, it's gonna be a protest! It's gonna be a protest!" One person showed up to that protest. The entire protest, one person shows up, and he's like, "I'm probably just like," he shows up and looking around like, "So where is this protest? Like, what's going on? Why isn't no one here?" So cops, all they had to do was just talk to one person. Convince him, hey buddy, it's in your best interest to go back home right now because we are in level 4 lockdown. And he's like, yeah, okay, fine. I guess I'm going back home. And then he went back home also. That was the end of the protest.
Yeah, well, one protester means it's not really a protest or something uncivilized. It's just somebody who's lost, which was me in the morning. I mean, really, what cop is going to bother twice? And he's probably one of these internet boys who's not seen daylight for days. So he comes out there, he's completely thrown, and he's probably holding some sort of, slogan, no more lockdown or autocratic New Zealand. He should come here. And then after coming here, he should go to Afghanistan. Everything is relative. The world should be traveled by everybody. And then you have a better perspective of where you are. Yeah. What do you think, Amit? Spend 6 months in a different civilization to understand who you are.
Yeah, I think that is the only way that you get a sense of the world, right? And also, that's the only way you find out whether or not... We're all insular in our own ways, right? What we were just talking about, the politics versus the this and that, right? We all have our own kind of insularities. So, yeah, being exposed to the wider world obviously is the most, is the better way to do that, is the best way to do that.
Insularity is also unlimited. Like for me now, I'm so insular, it's ridiculous. I can't think beyond my issues, which were anyway the problem. But with lockdown, don't you think it's become more compounded?
I think the lockdown has made being a loner easy, right? In some sense, because it's
fashionable.
Not just fashionable, right? I mean, there always used to be so much. Like, I like doing shit by myself, right? I like to read. I like to watch shit.
To read it in a group? Who does that?
They are reading
They discuss the book actually, Silvery. Huh. Those are book clubs because of bored women or sometimes men who have nothing to do.
But then there are author readings like in libraries and bookstores and all.
Yeah, but promote the book, Baba. So, but you actually.
I know, my
generation who read, by the way, beta. It was doubles tennis match. My sister and me sitting and saying, sharing the book.
what I was trying to say was actually more that it was. I used to have a lot
How
of social
sweetly
pressure.
He says that because we interrupted him in his flow with our inane imbecilic talk. Okay, go on. I'm so sorry.
No, no, I was just saying that it was very I don't like doing social stuff by inclination, right? I do it because you should do it. You should go out, you should meet people. It is good for you just generally, right?
But the Maya point about being asocial and not antisocial.
Huh?
As in you don't want to socialize, but you're not antisocial, which is disruptive force. So asocial. Okay, sure. Is I'm not so happy to be with people all the time, but I'm not anti people, and I don't want to make a disturbance and destroy people's minds.
I would
minds
say
and...
that's 100% correct. I don't like doing that at
because
all.
That's why people mistake that for asocial. Asocial is a lot of normalcy in that. I think lots of people have asocial moments.
Yeah. No, but again, you know, you'll have four friends call you and say that, hey, why aren't you coming out right now? And that makes you go, right? And the
peer pressure.
There is a certain amount of peer pressure which forces people like me who otherwise would be very happy to kind of just like read nonstop, right? It forces
people.
I'll give you
a hint. You get off Facebook, you get off Twitter, and you get off Insta and anything else. And you also make sure that your phone is on silent. I think that's the way to avoid people.
So I've been honestly, doing it for years. I think I do almost all of it. I have not.
How do they find you? How did those four guys find you?
Because they're my friends. They can call me and I have to respond back to them, no?
But if it's on silent, you didn't see the phone. I mean, you wouldn't know.
But there is such a thing as a missed call, and there is such a thing as the social pressure to call people back if they have called you.
But that means you viewed the phone. Amit, I can't teach you any more than this. You can take the horse to water, but if the guy wants to gargle and spit it back in, I can't do anything.
Cyrus, at some point, I'm going to see my phone. No? I'm not going to let my phone sit away for like 6 hours in a row.
You've got to break that bond. You've got to break that bond if you want to be truly asocial and live alone like a hermit. Trust me, this is not going to work.
That's the thing. I don't want to live like a hermit, right? But at the same time, I don't want to go out.
80% of you does. You don't realize what you're saying. 20% of you is doing it because you don't want to upset the other person. It's the so-called niceness quality which is overriding the actual feeling.
No, but you should. We are human. Human beings are social creatures. If I were to just sit by myself and, just all the time.
Did you create a companionship and go out, or did you do it because you felt you were duty bound to answer the call, and after all the pressure of being asked to go out, it looks really disgusting and arrogant on your part to not be part of the social group who you basically like? They're two different things. Did you create a companionship? No, you didn't.
I basically like them, and I have a good time when I go out with them. But my first thought is, do I really want to go all the way to Colaba right now?
Slightly revised version. I think you've spoken the honest truth here, and it's self-evident that the fact of the matter is, given a choice, Amit Doshi doesn't go out. But Amit Doshi can only behave like that up to a point because he feels guilty, and there's a sense of remorse, and he doesn't want to feel in that emotional space where he regrets something.
That's
even though deep down he doesn't want to do something.
But then
it's
I don't.
If your mom says
fetch
her from somewhere, I really don't want to fetch her. You're duty bound to fetch her. Fetch her. But you know, you would never not fetch her. But your first thing is, I wish I had another brother to fetch her. Something like that. You know what I'm saying?
My first thought here is that is laziness, right? That's the thing. Like peer pressure helps you overcome laziness.
I discuss this with
Maya. I enjoy myself. I don't.
You
it's not
get
that
it
I
on.
Go out and I see
it's
if
not
I
laziness.
Go,
uh-huh. There's no, your blood doesn't rush. Okay, when an NBA match is on at 5 in the morning, Amit Doshi gets up, he's excited, his favorite team is playing, whatever, you know, I mean, your mind is rushing, there's a lot of blood flowing in your brain. You see, or there's a pretty girl who catches your eye and you like her and she, you know, talks back to you. I mean, those kind of things. Here, it's not that. It's never that. You will go, but it's not your first thing. It's not in the top bracket of things you want to do. That's why being asocial is not a bad thing. Because you're actually being sincere. So you should just tell him, look, I really like you guys. You're great. I hope nothing ever bad happens to you. And I hope you all succeed in life. But today I want to just, you know, stay at home and watch stuff all on my own.
But sincerity at what level, right? To what degree, right? Because again, you want to, as a person, I want to live a life where I do have social relationships with people, right? If I cut myself off, how am I? I will no longer have relationships.
Turn
with people.
The internet back on and then go to Tinder and all these other new sites that he'll tell us about. And there are many ways to meet people. I find strangers, we've discussed this, are far more fun than friends. Because there's only so much you can do with friends. You know almost everything about them. And you can also predict the habits and etc. So, I mean, that's all there. There's nothing wrong with being asocial. Let's get people on who are asocial to speak the asocial gospel and tell people what the hell. It's no disrespect to the other party. Like, if you tell me I don't want to come to your wedding because I love the fact that you're getting married and I wish you the best, but I don't want to come to your wedding. I want to meet all these people. I wouldn't feel bad. Firstly, I'd be, you know, saving at that time 475 rupees veg and 675 non-veg straight away.
Okay, so it's not 2001. So I know that that's probably what you paid at your wedding.
The later you get married, just a segue, the later you get married, the more cost to company. Remember that. There's no way out of that. Inflation. Yeah.
But again, I think that weddings are different, right? I think weddings are
awesome. No. Wedding in India, I would feel, is a social stigma of all stigmas for not attending it. I had a couple of friends when I missed the wedding because I was shooting back in the day and I couldn't come back from Goregaon in time and change and all. It was like 11:30, 12. And they're very upset. They couldn't understand how you didn't, navigate that shoot and make sure you were there.
How can't you be there for the wedding? I know. It's a thing. I left the U.S.
I genuinely didn't bunk it.
Yeah. I left the U.S. 5 days before one of my cousin's kids was getting married, and it was a little bit of they were very nice at the end of it. But, I mean, there was a little bit of kind of like, oh, you're leaving now kind of.
So why do they feel, why do us Indians, maybe even foreigners, I'm not sure, why do people feel bad about the whole wedding thing, that you didn't make that ultimate commitment for the big one, the wedding?
I don't know.
But, I don't mind if you don't come to my, but I'm putting this out, if I get married again, don't come. Okay? Do not come. I'm no problem at all. But unless you hate the person, don't come because I don't like the guy. That's different. That's malice. I'm saying just don't come because you don't really want to be there because you're asocial. It's got nothing to do with I like Amit Doshi or Amit Doshi likes me. It's got nothing to do with that. You're just asocial.
That's a very enlightened point to look at it, right? Way of looking at it. I don't think most people look at it like that, right? I think that, honestly, I'm going to like kind of toot my own enlightenment here, right? I mean, like, weddings are things which I don't give a shit about. I don't go for weddings. I'll go if somebody very, very close is getting married, I'll go for that wedding. Other than that, my wedding, if there is somebody we have to go for a formality, I'll go for 5 minutes and I'll leave. I'll literally go for 5 minutes.
But jeans, in middle class India, there's not one family where the parents have not told the child or whatever, the family members, ki jana padega. We have to go for the Mehta's wedding. Okay, yeah. This conversation in every language of India from north, south, east, west takes place.
Happens.
And you land up going with this bloody wedding pressure, and then we pass on to the next generation. Why? No, because so-and-so, you work with him, he's a partner in the firm, blah, blah, blah. I don't know. Or the relative who's very close or to some other relative, and so we have to go. I don't know. But you have to go, and that pressure continues. Stop that pressure, India. Stop that pressure.
But again, there is pressure on it. It's annoying and it's aggravating, right? But the thing with the wedding is, the way I go for weddings, which I don't know the people well for, is I basically go to the reception, stand in line, do the wishing, and I leave. I don't don't even go for food or anything like that. But just go.
So you order your Uber when you're three people away from reaching them, or I order you do it after
Uber,
you finish.
I order my Uber on I order my Uber on my steps down, off the stage as I'm walking off the stage.
You're not that much of a optimist. I would do it two or three before, so that you can actually smooth exit. You're giving 5 to 7 to 10 minutes for the Uber to come.
You make a good point. Maybe I should. Maybe I can
How you went kicking and screaming, and then you just the gift in the hand or Piramni in the hand and run away. I mean, that's so wrong. Yeah. Why do we do all that? We spend 80% of our lives going to these functions and thinking how to get out of it. Don't you understand that there's a paradox there? That's no sense to me.
I when it comes to weddings, I agree with you, right? But the thing is, that's what I'm saying. Like, I separate weddings out from friends going out for dinner or friends going out to a bar or something like that, right? I wind up having fun when I do that. And that's why I'm okay with the pressure coming to do that kind of thing. Wedding pressure is aggravating. And wedding pressure, I react badly to as well. Are you really sure I have to go for this? Do I really, really have to go
for this? Anyway, if you get married, please excuse me. My okay. fondest wishes will be there, and I will send something for sure. No that's issue. Fine. But can I just skip the whole function thing?
That's
especially the main okay. wedding day where it's going to be veg and no booze or whatever. You know, that's also the guys working so hard on there. Look, the women. Your women folk are putting 3 hours of makeup and clothes and lehenga and venga and all. And they come there and then it's just going to be ice cream. In Maharashtra weddings, Kunal to his family weddings, they just give you ice cream. I mean, my whole family is decked up and Parsis, so it's the complete opposite. They're like, what? What happened? I mean, how cheap can this wedding be? Vanilla ice cream, no flavor option.
I actually think that's a great thing for a wedding, though. Honestly, if you think about it, just get people in and out. Listen, the wedding, you are the only one of
this
us.
This is the Firaz ka day. Huh? This is the actual wedding day. But they all had a good sangeet. Let's not rubbish everybody.
Okay, huh? but tell me this. Don't you think as somebody who actually got married, wouldn't you have preferred that people just had an ice cream and left instead of having to stand on that stage for multiple hours?
See, I was because drinking. You're I was lawyer. Drinking. No, I know those days I was drinking was fine, but my thing is my parents succumbed to the same pressure all middle class parents of India, the Punjabification of the wedding thing or whatever, or Hindi filmication of it, where you had to have a big wedding, spend a lot of money and invite everybody in the telephone book and more.
Yeah,
I mean, I didn't know anybody. We have like 20 friends, right?
Yeah.
Everybody has like 30, 40 friends. How many friends do you really have? And then you have work friends and whatever. So that's also the subgroup. And then you may have, maybe you have go to a club or you play tennis or whatever. You might have those little subsets all put together about 100 people. But we were 800 people. I didn't know who they were.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
everybody comes and says all personal things to you. Like, how many people said how you've grown so tall? I'm the shortest male in my family. You know, I mean, what do you know about my family, bro? What are you saying? I mean, it's really hurting. My dad's a 6 footer. And when I was 13, 14, my guys in my class were growing tall, getting that burst. I was like, why aren't I growing taller? You know, and me and my sister both are short compared to our parents and our grandparents and all. So, which I'm
and
so
also
happy.
And every wedding you go to, every wedding you go to, the groom and the bride are always the people having the least fun at their wedding.
The bride, I thought it was only North Indian weddings, but I've seen in South Indian weddings also, they put so much jewelry on that poor girl and she's stuck there. Like she's, it's better to, bondage would be better because she can't move her head, the stuff that's around the head and neck and all, man. And they actually, after 3-4 hours that you spend the whole day there, they actually talk like that. Yeah. They can't move the neck. You're like, Shivali, are you okay? I'm fine. I'm like, this is your wedding, your choice. So sad.
It's the most painful for them, right? I mean, like, and that's why, I mean, like, you know, the vanilla ice cream thing is actually a great idea. You come, you wish them, they have the vanilla ice cream and you go away, right? I mean, like, there's no...
But then we should be allowed short pants. But, you know, I mean, you have to find a suit. Okay, for us, still not so bad. Amit, I take 5 minutes to dress in a suit. My wife has to find a sari which she doesn't wear anymore. She takes a long time to put it on. Then she has to match accessories to it. We don't go out that much. So this is a huge process. My mother is old. Everyone is trying to find their jewelry for their thing. And you come, you're all decked up and you come there to show a little bit of, you know, this is us. We've come to attend the wedding. Ice cream. Vanilla ice cream. That's it. Yeah. All right. The breakfast has come. Okay. Shall we do the AMAs?
Let's do some AMAs.
The pressure started. 5 minutes. I'm talking off camera to my good friend. Sir, aapka naam kya hai? Dilip. Dilip, hello bolo kam se kam na. इन दोनों को नहीं बहुत लोग देखते हैं इंडिया में अफ्रीका में 5 million लोग देखते हैं एक साथ हाँ सबको हेलो बोल 5 million बार बोलना पड़ेगा we'll be here for some time that was Dilip who works here met him for the first time so great relationship if I meet him again he'll probably saw I can I quickly just before you aim is I just want to say and correct me if you think I'm right Amit especially and maybe celebrity also which is In our business, TV, I'm talking about, not so much film, but TV proper, the best department is the spot for me. They are unbelievable. For those who don't know, spot is the guy who looks after you hand on hand, the bonded laborer.
Not a moment's rest for them.
Not a moment's rest. And they start predicting. Yeah. Once they know that I like lassi, for example, there are 6 lassis inside the fridge when I come back. This is unbelievable. And they're waiting with the malmal. They're waiting with this. They're superb. The worst sound. The worst. Till today, 6 days of shooting, all the problems we had was sound. In the middle of the take, Russell. In the middle of the take, battery gaya. In the middle of the take, wire nickel gaya. In the middle of the take. Oh, and they take so long to put the damn thing and put the t-shirt. You can see the sound and the director is going crazy because the mic can be seen. Worst department and we won the Oscar. The irony, I just, you know, Russell Pokati representing the worst part of television wins the Oscar.
What Oscar? Who won an Oscar?
He won an Oscar? Sound Oscar?
Who?
Who? For that Anil Kapoor film, English film.
A.R. Rahman. Talking about A.R. Rahman.
No, Rasul Pokati. Rasul himself won the Oscar.
Who?
Rasul won the second Oscar.
Or 24 for which show?
For that billionaire thing.
David Boyle, Danny Boyle, huh?
Ah, okay, all right, okay. I didn't know that.
Guys, what's happened to you?
Oh yeah, yeah.
No, you didn't specify. No McDonald's for you.
I didn't know that they won the sound Oscar. Okay, all
right. Rasul, who worked at MTV with me, before he worked for Black. That's right. See, you're correct.
Yeah, yeah, no, I know the song. I know the movie. All of that I knew. I didn't know it had won a sound Oscar. Okay.
I didn't eat for 7 days. I have the first 2 years of his life. He worked with us. In our terrible low standard shoots.
And then A.R. Rahman won the music Oscar for that movie. Isn't that what
he won the sound design Oscar, Baba, for Danny Boyle?
Yeah, yeah, music composition, sound design.
Just check it, check
score,
it. There is a technical award, brother. A.R. Rahman is a composer, it's an art award. So,
yeah, so, that, yeah, so there is a, let's see, best. Wow, okay, it won quite a bit. Best sound editing.
There you go.
Best picture, best director, best original score, best cinematography, so last best time, sound mixing, best film editing, best adapted screenplay, best sound. It won 8 Oscars? Really?
Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. You guys are forgetting because the world is going too quickly now. Ben-Hur, we remember, you and me. Now, just to go back, the last time I met Rasul Pokati, I had to go to America, which finally I didn't go because it got cancelled with the UN, something to do with the United Nations. And I went to get the visa about 5 years back, 4 or 5 years back. And you can't take the mobile phone in. And I couldn't call my wife, who was parked outside somewhere, to tell her that I'm done because she couldn't keep the car close by.
Okay.
And I met Rasul wandering around outside. And I took his phone and because I know my wife's number by heart, I was able to call her. It was very sweet. And he found it very funny because he didn't know I had a phone. So he thought I still don't have a phone. So he was very happy with me. Yeah. But I must say, he was wearing his success quite well. He wasn't behaving badly or anything. For someone we used to scream at. Because they would always drive us mad with the interruptions. Yeah. He interrupted Amitabh Bachchan, my first damn interview with him. How could you interrupt Amitabh Bachchan and say crow, which is Malayali for crow? You know, I mean, really, we can live with that crow in the background. Clean up the sound a little bit. The great man doesn't want to talk. What am I going to do? Describe Major Saab without him and a poster? I mean, come on. You don't stop Amitabh Bachchan. Who takes that chance?
That is true. Rishi, you should be hearing this.
Rishi, never interrupt Amitabh Bachchan when he comes on our show, which will be probably Friday. Okay, let's go to AMAs, guys. I have to pretend to shoot.
Yes. Yeah.
The first one comes in from Soumit Iyer. He says, guys, when you eat at a restaurant, at what point do you take off your mask?
I take off my mask as soon as I sit on the table.
If I have to tell the truth and not lie, I basically wear it on my chin anyway. And only if somebody says anything, I push it up. So I'm pretty okay. I just leave it on my chin because until the time food comes, and then I take it out because we dirty it and things fall on it. But it's silly, right? You're at the restaurant, so are you really those 5 minutes of waiting for food and all? I mean, what difference does that make?
Once you're in, you're in, right? I mean, like
once you're in, you're in, and it's air conditioned. Please explain that to me. Air conditioned restaurant or non air conditioned gym? I don't get that. I don't understand that.
I remember in the beginning of the lockdown, like of last year, the first when pandemic first hit. I remember there was something out of the US where at a restaurant a couple had basically made holes in their masks, and they could just eat like noodles through the mask. So they did not keep taking the mask down and put it back up and back down. They made a hole in the mask and just eating through it. It was very bizarre, but very funny to see.
I think we discussed this before, but on airlines, if you've got long flights, you need to keep your water at least handy. Because that's an excuse to keep the mask half up, you know, I mean,
I feel like that's expected as well. Everybody expects you to do that, right? I mean, like, I just took 2 long flights, right? And everybody had, like, a bottle of water right next to them or a drink or, like, I don't think I've seen so many Diet Cokes ever being delivered during the course of a flight. And not just to me, to other people as well. But, yeah, it was just like, you know.
Even better, right? If you don't really want to drink it, because then you nurse it properly. I mean, if you really like drinking Diet Coke, you probably knock it back and get another one and have 5. But here you just have 1 tickle. The poor air hostess can't call you a bluff till such a time as there's turbulence. You just got to let it be. And you can take a sip every 15 minutes. That's your job. That's what happens. It's kind of Indian jugaad, but it's the world's jugaad now, isn't it? I'm sure everybody does it.
True.
Okay, next question, guys.
Next one from the same person. Somadhyaya has another great question. He has, Amit, has your car arrived? And are you nervous about driving after ages?
It's September, right?
It arrived. It came on Friday. I drove to office on Friday. I drove around on Saturday. It's fine. It's not that I am driving after ages. I've driven other cars. I drove.
Did you get the tag done? Because you're going to do tag every day.
The fast tag, yeah. It comes with it.
Okay. And just how much are you paying? Is there a monthly option? Because you'll be going every day almost.
It is a monthly option for the link.
No, are you paying like a day rate or are you paying like a special rate?
The way the link works now is that you basically the first time it charges you 70, the second time it charges you 35, the third time it charges you, I think, another 70, and then after that it doesn't charge you at all. So within a 24-hour period, if you go three times, then after that fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth is all free.
Yeah, but what kind of moron is going up and down eight times unless you're ferrying passengers? Yeah, I've been going every day for the last 7 days and I keep topping it up. I get worried because, you know, 100 odd every day, and then suddenly that if you put a grand in, it goes very quickly.
It's 105.
These are the problems of, you know, these are the problems we have while the people are dying in Afghanistan of basic rights.
But actually you have your own car, so maybe fuel costs would not be the same. But if you're going by cab and you go outside of the link and you go without the link, I've had this happen to me because for whatever reason, the cab guy, when I was coming back from Andheri, did not take the link. He's like, all right, you don't want to pay, so then I'll go from this way or whatever. I'm like, dude, I don't give a fuck about paying that $70. But he took us from the other thing. It cost me more than 70 rupees extra.
You think?
Yeah.
Time of day is important. If you do it early morning, it doesn't.
Early morning, it wasn't. This was about, maybe 7:38 in the evening.
Nobody should be out at that time except Panthers. I said that right at the top. 7:38, go home. You shouldn't be out.
I was on my way home only, no?
That's true.
I was on my way home from Andheri.
It's so far away. To quote Dire Straits, so far away. It's so at far that away. Point, look at me. I mean, when can we work again in South Bombay?
A normal Andheri to home trip for me is about $420. This was 600, not 600, but 570 or something like that. So I'm just like, dude, I'm not saving money. Why the fuck am I doing this? Why am I doing this? I mean, this makes no sense. Why would anybody do this?
Let's see. Let's give it a month and you give us an update on how you feel about being a car owner again. In the meantime, let's go to the next one.
Anxiety? The temper. Right, basically, I feel like I'm a generally even-tempered guy, and I feel like over the last 5-6 years, I've gotten even more even-tempered because I don't have these situations where I want to get out of the car and like basically break somebody's windshield.
Mother Teresa would have been facing assault charges if she drove a cab or a car in this city, for sure. She'd have lost it completely. There's no question in my mind that it's not possible to be a human being. Because it breaks you sooner or later. I've seen girls that I've grown up with who used to tell me why you're abusing when we're driving and all that. Now they drive and they're foul-mouthed as fisherfolk. It's unbelievable. Yeah. It just breaks you, man.
Yeah, because I mean, like, the people are idiots, man. They're just.
Have you seen the way the rickshaws in this part of the town come to the front of the signal and turn parallel into your car and stop? Yes. So they're profile to the signal?
Yeah.
I mean, who does that?
Can I tell you the thing that I almost like really lost my shit over?
Yeah.
Buses. Fuck, there's a bus stop. Go in. You don't have to stop in the middle of the damn road.
Yeah.
And the most aggressive people.
Yeah, but it was
most
so
aggressive people, the way they annoying. Drive. Yeah.
Because also it's just like, you know, they're also driving in a way where they don't want you to overtake them. Like, you know, when I'm going down, so this happened to me coming down Brishkandi Road, right? From this to going towards Mahalakshmi, right? And the guy is driving in a way where there's plenty of room on his left side, but he is driving half in the right lane.
Yeah.
So that nobody can overtake him.
All said and done, it's called bus. And that's one thing they don't seem to follow is the actual meaning of that word bus. Because they don't go fast, but they hold like dog in the manger the entire place. They don't let you overtake, as you say. And they're almost looking for a fight. Yeah. It's almost like they're looking for a fight all the time.
They will never get out of the car. So they're not even looking for a fight. No.
It's not a physical fight, Silvery. They're looking for a fight. They just want to irritate
by
you.
The mind.
Oh. Yeah, it's sledging.
Think about it like this, right? If you're a bus driver, is there a more mind-numbing job than being a bus driver?
It's the worst
this
job.
This is a way to entertain yourself. Let me see how much I can irritate this guy in this car. Yeah, Let me see how much I can irritate this guy.
They should be given Wi-Fi and allowed to watch movies and stuff while they drive. Just kidding. Actually, all right, let's take one more quickly, guys.
Yeah.
Hey, they can. Is that allowed? Yeah. You don't know this podcast while driving? Yeah, it's like music. It's like music, right? You should be allowed. Yeah.
Yes,
so maybe not ours, because we have such terrible views sometimes, distorted.
And they'll be listening to talk about themselves. Hey, Cyrus ne kya bola bus driver ke bare mein? Bola kaise?
Pura bus culture. It'll be like that Subramaniam kid, the famous comedian who the DJs went after. Remember? Rahul.
Yeah.
Rahul Subramaniam, the famous comedian. So all the DJs went after him over some one innocuous remark or set he did.
And then he made a joke about DJs going like tuck.
Yeah,
all of a sudden they all went after him.
You insulted the DJ community of India, and now the DJs will stand up and be counted. No more to take this shit. An underprivileged DJ community of India. Fair enough. I was a DJ for a little while. Siri, last question, please. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. This one is a comment before we get to the question. Vikram Goyal says, thanks for starting this separate YouTube channel. I've been wanting it since you started going live, but I thought it would be too much of an ask, so I never did.
No, listen, since we have only 9 or 10 people who are ardent followers, please say whatever you want. It's like customize. We do your doorstep. Whatever you want can be done. You can change the topics on the spot as well. Yeah. Well, I hope our YouTube channel stays now. And Antarish doesn't try any underhand.
Yeah, I won't.
It wasn't exactly jugaad, but you know, trying to find things careful. Without thinking it through. Yeah.
I've been extra careful now.
Okay.
Last one is Ruben David says, Cyrus looks a lot younger today. What's the secret?
The lighting. There's probably better lighting here in this dressing room that I'm in, I suppose.
Yeah, I think that's probably true.
I think the shirt also. You look very nice and crisp shirt.
Yeah, it's basically your shirt looks like a way a normal shirt looks like instead of like, you know, the super bodybuilder.
What a super insult. Yeah. What a lovely way to insult.
It's not insult, right? I mean,
what a normal shirt in a normal person doing a normal show would look like rather than some...
But that's how you dress, right? You dress with that, like, you know, the tight t-shirt kind of this, right? Whereas this
actually, those are my home t-shirts, Baba.
Even when you came to studio, you would dress like that, right? I mean, that's what you wear. Why are you not owning the fact that you like to wear tight t-shirts?
Wear them, Amit. It's not like I'm really going out of my way to wear them. But okay, fair enough. I'll accept this criticism like a man.
It's not criticism, man. I'm saying that you're dressed differently. That's all I'm saying.
Well, the rest of the suit is behind me. I just took it off so I don't sweat too much. By the way, our purples are almost the same, huh?
Silver? Yeah, very similar. Yeah.
Mine is slightly lighter version. Yours also. How come you in a purple? Why are you in a full sleeve shirt? Since you're at home.
Just looking formalish on this podcast. I'll take it off after this anyway. It's fine. I'll be naked for the rest of the day.
Strange young man. And just to remember, around the 15th of September, you'll be going back to the office and some of the podcasts will be from there. So maybe we can get a guest or two to come in at some point.
Yeah,
that'll be great. At least Cock and Bull we can do together.
The three of us can do it together.
Yeah.
Whole different feel.
There's one last cricket question for you, Cyrus.
Yeah.
Janil Bain asks, Cyrus, your thoughts on the third test match? And should Kohli sit out the next match and let SKY come in?
You got to stop that. I missed the whole match as in live broadcast because of pretending to work in some strange studio. But I saw all the highlights in the night on my phone. And... how can you drop Kohli? You can't drop Kohli.
Kohli. It's a ludicrous suggestion face. Kohli, I don't know. I don't even know cricket.
In the last 11 tests, he's averaging 27, which makes him the poorest average of the top six batsmen, maybe Rishabh Pant. So that there's a question there. But the point is, he's Virat Kohli. He's the captain. There's no question right now. But I can see where that's going. If his form was to not improve, one more series, or we would lose badly. But it's too early to make that call. And honestly, he's half the team. His personality, his stamp. He's a fantastic once-in-a-generation cricketer. So I'm sure his form is just temporary and it'll come back. But having said that, I'm more worried about why Ashwin is not playing and Jadeja is being persisted with. I want Ashwin to play as that spinning all-rounder option instead of Jadeja. Hopefully that'll happen because Jadeja is injured now with his knee. So it's possibly won't play the fourth game. But great for cricket. We won one test match. They look like rubbish, then they win the test match and we honestly look like rubbish, especially our bowling. After a long time, all the praises for the bowlers and Ishan Sharma was all over the place. Don't start me off. It's the beginning of a day. Don't make me depressed. Anyway, so guys, have a good one. I'm going to start off with some strange muck chicken thing and then get on with the shoot. My love and wishes to all of you in South Bombay and Powai, both far away. One day our trails will meet and we will be friends again.
Have a nice shoot, Cyrus.
All right.
As we say in Lucknow, adios, amigos.
Bye-bye. Yes.